Welcome back. So today we are now going to look into the problem of how to handle inequality constraints. See, now we have we went some steps. First we did convex programming, which treated constraints in a very abstract way, you know, that they come from a convex sets. Then we tried to be a bit more explicit. And we said that, okay, then let the constraints be linear equality constraints. Then subsequently, we generalized our discussion to a treatment to consider the case where the constraints are still equality, but could be nonlinear. Now, the final steps that we need to complete this story is that we should now consider first the how to handle linear inequality constraints, and then finally how to handle linear nonlinear inequality constraints. So once we have reached, once we finish at this point, at that point we can say we have hit some landmark in our journey of the study of optimization theory. So towards that end, let me consider a simple example problem, which is minimize, let's say, x1 minus 2 whole square plus x2 minus 2 whole square subject to the constraint that x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 1. So if I sketch it here, this is my axis and let me call this point as 2, 2, and so what I am going to get is basically the loci of the objective function are going to be concentric circles like this, is it not? So not good at drawing, so hey, whatever comes now, we will accept this as my best drawing. And whatever. So we'll get concentric circles of like this circle, for example, has object. This has radius of 1. This has the radius of. This has a radius of 1. And the objective function value will be therefore 1 square, 1 if I substitute 1 square plus 1 square, which is objective function value is going to be 2. So this may be like objective function value of 4, this may be like objective function value of 1, and so on. Then I am putting a constraint that I am putting a constraint that x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 1. So I have a constraint x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 1. So I have this as my constraint. Okay, so or let me modify this constraint as x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 2. So the constraint I am modifying as x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 2. Okay. it intersects at 0 to, I'm sorry, 2, 0. And 0 to at these two points. Okay, we are minimizing over x1 and x2. So it is clear to you that by the geometry of the problem that this objective, this solution is when the straight line x1 plus x2 is straight line x1 plus x2 is equal to 2 is tangential to the circle. Why? Because first of all, this is the unconstrained global minimum of value 0. Now this point 2,2 is infeasible. What is the feasible region here? The feasible region is this side, because x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 2. So this is my feasible region, is it not? So I have 2,2 point is a infeasible point. So I keep increasing the circle so that I come closer and closer to the constraint until I touch the constraint. When I touch the constraint, I get actually the minimum value of the objective function, which is with a feasible point, and then constraint minimum. And then if I increase the radius further, then I have many feasible points, two boundary points, and all of these also feasible points, but they all give me objective function value which is more than what I got by touching, so therefore they are not optimal points. So at the point where it touches, you can see that the gradient of the objective function, which is shown here, and the gradient of the constraint, which is shown here, I'll just call it as A transpose, they are in opposite direction and collinear, and therefore if I have a positive multiplier, which I will find out soon, if I have a positive multiplier lambda times this normal n which I have shown here, the normal A which I have shown here, then this will become equal to lambda is positive, then this summation will go to 0, and this is exactly the algebraic form of of the optimality condition. So we are considering in general a problem: minimize f of x, x is differentiable, and ax is less than or equal to b. Okay, this is the form of constraint that I am considering. I will consider if A is a m cross n matrix, x is a n cross 1 vector, b is a m cross 1 matrix, I will consider that rank of A is m, linearly independent, not critical, but a very similar kind of descriptive logic that I gave in the equality constraint case, same logic will hold here, and therefore all linearly dependent things can be dropped off, and I'll just consider rank of A is equal to m. Then and I am trying to minimize this function, then I am going to show that I can write at if x star is an optimal, then I have the condition that gradient of f of x of star plus of A transpose lambda is equal to zero vector. And you have seen this condition earlier also with the equality constraint case. The only additional thing that I am now going to stipulate to handle inequality constraints is that lambda has to be greater than or equal to zero. This is the additional stipulation that I am making here. Okay. Now this is important, and so you could think of this as two things here. You could think of it as I have written a Lagrangian function. Now that you know how to write a Lagrangian function, and then obtained a stationary point of the Lagrangian function, at x star lambda star, and this is what I have done. Further, I have to stipulate one more thing. In addition to the fact that lambda has to be greater than or equal to zero, I have to stipulate one more thing, that for active constraints, active or binding constraints, lambda is greater than or equal to zero. This is just a repetition of what I already said. For inactive or non-binding constraints, lambda is defined to be zero. Okay. So now question must have cropped in your mind. What is an active or a binding constraint? What are active or non-binding constraints? So for this very example problem, suppose that I stipulate two more constraints here. Okay. X1 is greater than or equal to zero, and let us say x2 is also greater than or equal to zero. Suppose I stipulate this, then what is the feasible region? Feasible region is this triangle in the first quadrant. Now the optimal is this only, where it touches x1 plus x2 equal to 2. Because if I increase further the radius, objective function value is increasing. So then this constraint is called the active constraint or the binding constraint, while these constraints are non-binding because they have no role to play in this minimization. They are far away from the at the optimal point. Let's say this optimal point is 1, 1. We'll check later on, but let's say for the sake of discussion right now that this point is 1, 1, then 1 is strictly greater than 0. So therefore, it is not binding. It is not at equal to. It is non-binding or inactive constraint. Similarly, x2 is also 1. So 1 is also strictly greater than 0. Therefore, this constraint is also non-binding. But 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. So the less than is not active. It's exactly the equal to which is active. So whenever the equal to becomes active, we say that it is a binding constraint. Otherwise, it is a non-binding constraints. Now, it's clear, right? Whether if I had specified x1 greater than or equal to 0 or x2 greater than or equal to 0, even if I had not specified it, then the non-binding constraints would not have played any role. So even if I have dropped this, I won't have faced any problem in my solution, right? So therefore, actually, when we write the optimality conditions, that is when we are checking if x star can be treated as optimal, then the non-binding constraints can simply be dropped. They don't play any role. Only the binding constraints play a role. So what we do is, for non-binding constraints, we in this Lagrangian function, we just associate, this is sigma lambda I AI transpose X minus BI, I equal to, if there are M constraints, I equal to 1 to M. And we are checking if X star is optimal or not. So at that, for non-binding constraints, we simply say lambda I is 0, which means that they don't play any role in our optimality at all. I mean, but it's a nice way of saying, it's a one way of saying that, it's one way of treating them in a generic sense by saying that their Lagrangian multiplier is 0. Other way could be that we say that we only define Lagrangian multiplier for binding constraints, and we simply don't define them for non-binding constraints. You will find both the views practiced in different textbooks. They are one and the same. Okay. So now let us come back to this idea of why. Now, the main thing that we have to get a handle on is this additional thing that lambda has to be greater than or equal to 0. This is the additional thing on which we need to get a handle. Let's see how we can get it. Let X star be an optimal, because we are trying to derive optimality conditions at X star. So let X star be a optimal point to our problem. Okay. Then we are trying to say that what we are trying to derive is that this is equal to 0 and lambda star is greater than or equal to 0. Then X star satisfies the following. These are the necessary conditions that we are trying to now derive. Is that clear? What is the necessary condition we are trying to derive? It is a stationary point of the Lagrangian function. It is a feasible point, and the Lagrangian multipliers are non-negative. And one more thing, lambda i's are 0 for all i's which are belonging to the set of inactive constraints. So what I mean to say is, I will use a terminology called A of X star to indicate set of constraints which are active or binding, one and the same thing. They mean the same thing, which are active or binding at X star. So you keep changing the point, the set of binding constraints will keep on changing. If I change my point, suppose discussion point here, this is not, of course, an optimal. So your necessary conditions will not be satisfied here. But if I change it here, then the constraint active by AX will consist of indices 2 and 3. This is constraint number 1. This is constraint number 2. This is constraint number 3. So the 2 and 3 will now be the binding constraints here. At this point, the active set has only one constraint, which corresponds to constraint number 1. So this is my constraint number 1, and these are my constraint numbers 2 and 3. So this index of what is binding, that this A of X here, this keeps on changing. This keeps on changing as I keep on changing the point. At optimal, lambda I has to be 0 for the set of constraints which do not belong to the binding set compulsorily by definition. For binding sets, it can be either 0 or positive. Okay, good. Now, mathematically, the binding set means what? Mathematically, no, let us assume that all our constraints are binding only, means the non-binding constraints I have thrown away, and my A set is now made up of A, the constraints AX less than or equal to B is made up of all binding constraints only. So then what is happening here? AX star will be equal to B. Okay. All of them are binding, because non-binding ones anyway don't matter. Why don't they matter? Because for optimality, you just take small incremental feasible steps, and with respect to, let's say, this point, we are at this particular point, right? These two are our non-binding constraints. Now, whatever feasible direct step I take with respect to this point, for small, you know, infinitesimally small feasible steps, if I take in any of these directions, AP less than or equal to zero, will I ever touch this, any of these two constraints? I will not, right? So, and optimality, we only have to show that there is existence of a neighborhood in which this point cannot be improved upon. That's all. The neighborhood can be as small as we want, but just a non-zero neighborhood in which all feasible points in that neighborhood will not improve the objective function value which we are getting here. So if I have these non-binding constraints, then corresponding AI transpose X star is strictly less than the corresponding BI. So if I take a small enough step, epsilon P, I can always keep that epsilon below a certain threshold so that I will not hit those constraints. And hence, the non-binding constraints can be ignored. These constraints, all incremental feasible points, whatever direction I take, it has no impact on it will not cause any change in the objective function value or because the corresponding Lagrangian multipliers associated are zero. I'll come back to this one minute. I'll come back to first. Let me look at all the okay. So let me look at this set of binding constraints. All right. Now, what happens is, if I am at the optimal, okay, I should be if X star is an optimal, it of course should be optimal to this restricted problem, because if it is not optimal to this restricted problem, see, this problem has bigger feasible region than, so this is my LEP problem and this is my LIP problem. The feasible region here, feasible region here is greater than or equal to the feasible region here. Because I can move away from AX equal to B also. That's the reason why I have a bigger feasible region here. So, suppose it is not optimal with respect to this problem, then I can just improve the solution here and I am still in the feasible space of this. So, then how can I be optimal with respect to this? So, therefore, if I am optimal with respect to the IP problem, obviously I have to be optimal with respect to LEP problem, corresponding LEP problem defined with the active or binding constraints. So therefore, what immediately I get this, that gradient of f of x of star, immediately I get that gradient of f of x of star plus a transpose lambda star should be equal to 0. Is it not? This we did in the in our LEP problem itself. This ascertains, what does it ascertain? This ascertains with respect to a binding problem, okay? When you just say AX star is equal to B, with respect to the binding problem, what is the feasible P direction along which you can move? The feasible P direction which you can move is this, or this, being on these constraints itself, right? In other words, orthogonal to the normal of the constraint surface, or what we had written as AP equal to 0. So the P direction is orthogonal to the normals associated with this constraint surface. So you can just move on this line, and if you are not optimal with respect to this line movement itself, then you can improve it. For example, if you had taken it here, you could have come just down here. So therefore, the larger radius would have been here, and you could have reduced the radius and you would have come down here. So you have to be optimal with respect to this problem. And hence, I said that what we had derived for LEP problem will always stand. But LEP problem did not require lambda star to be greater than or equal to 0. That's an additional thing that is coming now with our LIP problem, the linear inequality constraint problem. The reason is, see, in a LEP problem, you have only this possible direction movement as feasible movement direction, as the feasible direction. But with LIP problem, this is also feasible. This is also feasible. All these P directions which take you away from the active constraint. Okay, all this which take you away from this active constraint are also feasible. So your point x star, must be optimal with respect to directions which I'll say feasible directions, I'll be more precise. I'll say feasible directions which make binding constraints, I'm putting it in bracket, which means one or more of them, non-binding. If along those non-binding movements, by where I would have relaxed the binding nature of them, if the objective function was reducing, then obviously that would mean that actually I am allowed to take that, and therefore I am no more at the optimal solution. So point x star, so in other words, what we further want to say is that if I choose AP such that A times of P is less than or equal to 0. So AP equal to 0 case we have already considered. This is the corresponding LEP case. This direction P is in the null space of the matrix A is the case of LEP, which we have already considered, and one should be optimal with respect to that. That already we have derived. In addition, we want to permit one or more of these constraints to be less than or equal to 0. So 0, minus 1, 0, for example. You could have minus 0.05, minus 0.10, or you could have minus 0.05, minus 1, and minus 2. With all such all such directions which are feasible directions, you should still remain at optimal. This is very important. These are all feasible directions, all right? So with all these feasible directions, you should remain at optimal. But question, is this a feasible direction? Is this a feasible direction? No, not at all. This is not a feasible direction. Why? Because the second, if AX star is B, okay? If AX star is B and you take a small positive step alpha in this direction P, given here as, these are various choices of P we are considering, and in the fourth choice, what is going to happen? The second constant is binding. Now you take a positive step. So A2 transpose P is greater than 0 and alpha is also greater than 0. You always take a positive step in a given direction. Then what happens? The constraint is violated. You had to be less than or equal to. Now your A2 transpose X becomes greater than B2, which is violation. You move into an infeasible region. So therefore, when I say there are actually infinitely many choices here, all of them are non-binding and feasible movement direction for this LEP problem. And our problem is that point x star should be optimal with respect to all such directions P which satisfy this requirement. We already saw that a subsection of this is AP equal to 0, and for this has already been handled by saying that this should be equal to 0. Okay, so now let us try to relax a binding perturbation, a binding constraint and see what additional restriction we have to place on lambda star so that X star is an optimal, because we are started with the fact that X star is an optimal. X star is an optimal means what? X star is an optimal means if I take a step alpha, positive step alpha along a direction P such that AP is less than or equal to 0, then FX star plus alpha P should always be greater than or equal to FX star. If for a small positive step I get this, then it means I am not at optimal. Is it not? So therefore, we have to make sure of this particular thing. So for LEP, we have already derived this. So what I am going to do is, I am going to write now gradient of f of x of star to be equal to minus of A transpose lambda star. Okay. Now, if you expand this by Taylor series, what do you get if you expand this by Taylor series? You get this as f of x of star plus alpha times of gradient of f of x of star times of p plus half of alpha square by 2 p transpose Hessian of x star plus theta alpha p times of p. And we know that if alpha is kept small enough, then and this is not equal to 0, then the second term dominates the third term, and therefore the sign of the summation of second plus 3 is only decided by the sign of the second term, right? So that basically means that if x star is optimal, then fx gradient of fx star transpose p should be greater than or equal to 0. In the LEP case, we were saying that it should be 0. In now we are saying that it should be greater than or equal to 0. If it is less than 0, then you take that small step, and this being positive step and this being negative, and that's for small enough alpha, this whole thing also becomes negative. And so the new point becomes a better point, strictly better point than f of x of star, and therefore x star is not optimal. So this, to rule this possibility, we write this. So now look at this expression, okay, and look at this requirement. So what do I do? First I take transpose of this and then multiply it by p, is it not? So I therefore have a requirement now that f of x of star transpose, which is minus of lambda star transpose a times of p should be greater than or equal to 0, but should be greater than or equal to 0. But AP is less than or equal to 0. That means minus of AP is greater than or equal to 0. So what does that mean? What can now I say about the lambda star? I can say that lambda star also should be greater than or equal to 0. I'll explain it a bit further. Okay, let me say that I will take first step, I will take a direction p such that a1 transpose p is less than 0. So let's say less than 0 means, let me take, give a number to it, feasible step, right? So the feasible step is given by ap less than or equal to 0. So I am going to choose AP to be equal to minus 1 and all 0. Okay, that means A1 transpose B will be, if I take a unit step, I will reduce the first, I will move away in the feasible space from the first binding constraint by a distance minus 1. That means I will go from B1 to B1 minus 1, while I will keep other constraints binding, because A2 transpose P is 0, A2 transpose P is 0, and so on. So this is how I am going to choose my P. No question. Does this equation have a solution? Answer is yes, it has a solution. Why does it have a solution? Because I have taken rank of A to be M. So, and B vector is in Rm. So, therefore, the complete Rm is in the range space of A. So, any vector I choose here, I will find a P which will be such that AP is equal to this value. For every B here, because rank of A is M, the system of equation is feasible. So, therefore, I'll always get some P which will meet this requirement. So, in other words, I can always find a P which is in the null space of the constraints 2 to M and which relaxes the first constraint. So, now once you have chosen P like this, what happens to your f of x of star times of p? This will become equal to, I'll write this as minus lambda 1 to lambda m times minus 1 from minus 1 and 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, which is lambda 1. But what is my requirement? My requirement is that this should be greater than or zero. So what does that mean? That means lambda 1 has to be greater than or equal to zero. So this is so simple actually. The lambda, the constraint equate, the what we have given here, the optimality constraints that we have given here are essentially those of the LEP problem only, but with further restriction that for binding constraints, any movement of feasible direction, any movement which is feasible, any direction which is feasible and which makes this one or more of these binding constraints non-binding should be such that objective function will not reduce any further, and that requires the lambda is to be greater than or equal to zero. And if you are taking infinitesimally small step, you know, and you are away from a non-binding constraint, that will never make you cross, and reach into infeasibility with respect to the non-binding constraint. So therefore, non-binding constraints, we don't have to worry with them. We will associate a zero Lagrangian multiplier, and that's about it. So now let's close this first order condition by solving this example of that we had started with x1 minus 2 whole square minimize plus x2 minus 2 whole square subject to x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 2. Geometrically, I have already seen that this has to be binding. In fact, I can also keep this and this. So, in this case, you have six choices of binding or constraints or active constraints. But by geometry, we have figured out that the first choice is all that is important. So, I will write for this zero Lagrangian multiplier. I will by definition write a zero Lagrangian multiplier for this. And I am going to only keep, I have to only show, find out this lambda, which should be greater than or equal to zero. So, what is the gradient of objective function? It is 2 times of x1 minus 2 and x2 minus of 2 plus, so I get, and what is my A matrix, binding A matrix, 1 and 1. So therefore, I get, when I write this to be equal to 0, I get 2 times of x1 minus 2, 2 times of x2 minus 2, plus of 1, 1 lambda star. There is only one lambda, so I will call it as lambda 1 itself, plus of lambda 1 is equal to, should be equal to 0. And if I also need x1 plus x2 to be equal to 2. So by symmetry of the above two equations, I will argue that the good choice would be x1 and x2 to be equal to 1. So if I take that as a choice here, I get minus 2, minus 2, plus 1, 1, and then I take lambda 1 star to be equal to 2 will give me 0, 0. So x1 star is equal to x2 star should be equal to 1, and lambda star is 2, and therefore the first order necessary conditions are met. First order necessary conditions are met. Now, if the function is twice continuously differentiable, then what would be the second order necessary conditions? The same at least as that of LEP problem should be there. So therefore, this is the second order necessary condition, is that Z transpose HX star should be positive, semi-definite, where Z is the null space. Z is the null space basis of active constraints. Not all constraints, mind you, only the active constraints. Only you have to worry about the active constraints, is the null space basis of the active constraints. Further, necessary conditions, again, you know that necessary conditions, you know that if they are satisfied, it doesn't mean that you are at the optimal. But if sufficiency conditions are satisfied, then you can guarantee to be at the optimal. So therefore, we have also to discuss the sufficiency conditions, and the sufficiency conditions could be many. Sets of sufficiency conditions can exist. Further, following is one set of sufficiency conditions. So I am giving you one set of sufficiency conditions. What is that set? First of all, I am going to say that lambda I is strictly greater than 0 for I coming from the binding constraints. And this is further. That means, further means the necessary conditions anyway have to be satisfied. But in addition, if lambda I's are taken to be strictly greater than 0, then you can see here that with respect to any non-binding perturbation, what will happen? Objective function value will strictly increase. If this is positive, then in the first order sense, objective function value is strictly increased. So you are, it is a strict increase is given. That is the sufficiency measure in the first order sense of non-binding perturbations. And with respect to the second order conditions, we will have to specify like what we did in the LEP case, that this should be positive definite. So what this means is, now please understand it carefully, don't get confused at all. What this means, this says strictly optimal with respect to non-binding perturbations. Okay. And binding also, of course, means non-binding perturbation strictly. And this says this and this together, one and two together, says strictly optimal with respect to binding perturbations also. See, when you look at the binding perturbations, then your gradient, this becomes equal to zero for the binding perturbations. So the second order condition becomes important, and this ascertains that the projected Hessian is positive definite, ascertains that the, because of this curve, if you move away from x star, the function value strictly increases. Where does it come from? It comes from this particular point. So if this is strictly greater than zero, anyway this term dominates, so I don't have to worry about this. So for non-binding perturbations, if all the perturbation, if I am considering in that sense, this takes care of non-binding perturbations. With binding perturbations, this becomes zero. So this becomes important, and my objective function should increase in the sufficiency case even for this movement, and that I guarantee by saying that the projected Hessian with respect to the active constraints is positive definite. So we will take a break here. Thank you.